and very soon we're going to see the King. How many of y'all believe that? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm telling you, Obama doesn't have the answer. Neither does any of our senators and the people that are in government office. But I want to tell you who has the answer. And his name is Jesus. And he's coming after a glorious church. Soon and very soon, we're going to see the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Jim, I asked Brother Jim to lead. He's had a problem with his, he had a fracture, and he's having a problem getting around and walking. And we just pray God to just bless him, and that he'll be able to help us lead singing, amen. We need help, amen. Anybody else can lead singing, well, you come up to me after the church. We'd be glad to let you come tonight and lead, amen. Praise the Lord. How many folks we have today are visiting or guests? Would you just raise your hand? Yes. Good to have you with us today. Welcome, Mary and I.
Tell your neighbor, this is not going to be a funeral. It's not going to be no funeral.
message. But it's going to be a revelation of what the Lord is doing in our lives and what He wants to do with us. And let's look at the word of the Lord together. Psalm chapter 23 and verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Can you say amen? Father, we just ask Your blessings and favors now. Lord, use us. Let us hide under the shadow of the Almighty this morning. And may the words that I speak be the word that You have me, praise God, to have for this congregation. Now, Lord, take us and use us. Mold us like clay in the potter's hand. I pray and ask it in Jesus' name. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. God has sent me to this pulpit this morning to tell you that He has a table spread for you. He sent me to tell you, praise God, that your cup is not just going to be full, but your cup is going to run over. He sent me this morning to give you the message that the anointing that He has, He has an anointing that's going to come upon you. In the verse 1, He talks about that the Lord is my shepherd. What credentials does He have to be my shepherd? Who is this Jesus? Who is this one who died upon the cross of Calvary? We would ask Him the question this morning, who are you, Lord? Can you tell me a little bit about your family? Can you tell me a little bit about yourself? I can hear Jesus say, well, on my mother's side, I was from Nazareth. But on my father's side, I was from the beginning. On my mother's side, I cried, I thirst. But on my father's side, I said, I am that living water. Praise God, that if you drink that blood, you'll never thirst again. On my mother's side, I cried, I was hungry. But on my father's side, He said, I am the bread of life which came down from the heaven, that if any man eat thereof, he'll live and not die. Hallelujah. So I believe He's qualified to be my shepherd. Give Him praise this morning. I want you to see the revelation of Psalm 23. Psalm 23 is such a powerful passage of Scripture that David wrote. It talks about going from the natural to the supernatural. It talks about a transformation, a metamorphosis, if you would please. How that a caterpillar, after a time, turns into a beautiful butterfly. At first, David talks about sheep, and he tells that we are sheep of His pasture, and that our Lord is our shepherd. And there's something about sheep. I don't like sheep because they're dumb. I realize, you know, that I don't have a high IQ, but I don't like to be called a dumb sheep. But you can see the transformation of the sheep going through the valley and coming out on the other side and being a soldier. This is the revelation. This is the transformation that the Lord wants us to see. That in the valley, praise God, is where He restores our soul. And verse 1 says, God is our provider that we shall not want. He is our Jehovah Jireh, our provider. And praise God, He will take care of us in the good times, in the bad times. He's the all-sufficient God. Hallelujah. You'll never be in want when you count on God. He's an awesome God. No matter the condition around you, praise God, He can meet your need. No matter where He may lead you, He will meet your need. No matter what comes your way, He can meet your need. Hallelujah. He is your provider. He is your provision. And He owns it all. Praise God. And He can provide for His children. He said, if I see a sparrow fall, can I not lift that sparrow? And I'm telling you that He is our provider this morning. Verse 2 says, with a demanding voice, He said, I will make you. I'm 63 years old. There ain't too many people that make me do what I don't want to do. Well, one, she's teaching children's church this morning. Did I hear an amen from the men? Amen. Well, things we don't want to do, but that little lady, you know, gives a commanding voice.
Yeah.
I will make you carry out the garbage.
Woo!
Hallelujah. But the demanding voice of the Savior to make the sheep lay down. God is saying, if I'm going to be your shepherd, and you're going to be the sheep of my pasture, then you must hear my voice, and you must obey my voice, that when I speak, you'll listen to the command, and you may do exactly what I say. Then he said, I will lead them to green pastures.
Yeah.
He'll take us to places in our life, praise God, where it's prosperous. The grass, hallelujah, the grass that he's talking about, and with the sheep. What would happen in those days was, the shepherd would take the sheep into tall grass. It would be around knee high. And the sheep would get in there and they'd begin to feed and they'd become full. And after they become full, they would want to lay down. There was where the sheep was very vulnerable.
Yeah.
That's where we are vulnerable.
Woo!
Sometimes we need to get hungry.
Yeah.
My sister Sandra, she comes sometimes to the service and says, preacher, I'm hungry. That's the way we need to come to church and be hungry for God. Hallelujah. But I'm here to tell you that He has green pastures for all the folks, praise God, that are hungry this morning. And He'll lead you into those green pastures. And what He does, that the sheep become full and they lay down. They become vulnerable because also in the tall grass, the wolves like to come. And the wolves are there to devour the sheep.
Amen.
And what the wolves will do is they will get down and they'll crawl almost on their bellies.
Yes.
That you can't see them. The shepherd is watching over his sheep.
Yeah.
And he can't see the wolves, but they're there. But the reason why he commands them all to lay down. One of them is supposed to be stirring around. He said, lay down. He commands them to lay down. And the sheep lay down. Now what he does now is he watches over the field. As he looks over the field, he can see the grass. And if the grass begins to move, he knows that there's a wolf coming in toward the flock. Hallelujah. Sometimes he makes us do things we don't want to do, but it's for our own welfare and for our own good. He's protecting us from the enemy. Hallelujah. Greater is he that is within you today than he that is in the world. Hallelujah. He'll protect you, praise God. If we obey the voice of God, the wolf cannot get us. He said, my sheep know my voice. And a stranger they will not follow. When the wolves would come in for the near the flock, he would watch over them. He wouldn't look at the sheep. He would watch the grass and the field. Sometimes we feel like, Lord, why aren't you looking at me? Why aren't you looking at me, Lord? Didn't you see, Lord, when I failed? Didn't you see, Lord, when I went through this problem? Didn't you see, Lord, when I had this difficulty? Didn't you see, Lord, when I was sick? And what he was saying to us, he said, I'm watching over you. Hallelujah. You go through this. You come through this. But there's a wolf out there that wants to drag you to the depths of hell. And I've got to watch him to keep him from getting to you. Hallelujah. Oh, my God is amazing. He's an amazing God. Hallelujah. And he protects us from the enemy. Praise God. We often feel that God is not watching us. That God turned his head when I was in trouble. He didn't pay no, he was asleep on the pillow. God didn't pay no attention to me. He didn't hear me. Nothing was going on. And why in the world did you do this, Lord? Then David said, he leads me beside the still waters. Lord, why don't you lead us into deeper waters? He leads you beside still waters.
Yes, amen.
He leads you beside the still waters.
Yes.
If you know anything about a river, you know that if it's if if it's babbling and it's moving, then it's very shallow.
Yes.
But there's places in the river that there becomes very still, and the water barely moves.
Yes.
Those are the deep places.
Ooh.
And the reason why the shepherd cannot take you into the deep places is because you have too much wool on you. Y'all want me to preach to you now? Here I come. I'm going to tell you about some wool.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you that wool weighs you down.
Woo.
You don't want to ever get in the water if you're the sheep and have a lot of wool. That wool I call sin. That wool is stuff. That wool is things that attach themselves to us. That wool is things that we just let go of God. Those little besetting sins. The word of the Lord tells us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily beset us. Let us swim, run this race with patience. The reason why David led the sheep beside the still waters because he knew if he led them into the deep waters that they would drown.
Amen.
I want to tell you, God wants to move this church into deep waters because he can't move some of us because, praise God, we have too much stuff in our life, too much wool, too much sin, too many little things, too many hidden things, too many agendas, too many things going through our mind, too many things that have control over us, too many things, hallelujah, that we need to lay aside for the Lord. I'm preaching to the church this morning. I'm talking to you about a wool. I look at some woolly sheep this morning. And you know what? If we want to be moved into deeper waters, we have to be sheared.
Yeah.
We got to get the wool off. We got to cut it off of our life. We got to get it out of our life. Hallelujah. You see, what's happened, I believe, in the last days we're living in, is that people have, and the church is guilty of this, trying to be so much like the world. They're just exactly like the world now. I remember back, praise God, when folk used to believe that you had to cut away some things. You had to lay aside some things. You had to give up some things. Hallelujah. You had to walk a pure and holy and clean life. That's why God is not taking us into the deep moves of God in the Spirit. It's because we have too much of the world in us. Thank you for that amen, brother and brothers. Because, my brother and my sister, the wool weighs you down. The sin sets you back. All these things that have control of you keep you in bondage. You say, why can't we have a move like they did in Brownsville, Florida? Why can't we have a move like they did in Canada? We can have a move just like that. But the good shepherd has to lead you beside the still waters. Because you're not ready for the deep. You're still living in the shallow places. The reason why I know that you're still shallow is because you're still complaining. You're still gossiping. You're still finding fault. Can I go on? And that's why he has to lead you beside the still waters. But the day that you lay it all down before the Lord and say, Lord, sanctify me, holy, cleanse me. Oh God, cut off the things of my life that's not pleasing of you. That's the way. Some wool and some things in our life. God is taking many through the shallow. shallow crossings because they're not ready for the deep places. And then in verse 3, he says that he restores my soul.
Yeah.
How many of you have ever restored a house or remodeled a house? Let me see your hand. God help me. First thing you know when you restore anything, you got to tear down the thing that's old. Throw it out. Carry it off. Go to Lowe's or Home Depot and get some more stuff. Bring it back. Put it up. And it costs more than it would if you built brand new. To restore anything is very costly.
Yeah.
It's very time consuming. And when you get done, it's beautiful. But it costs you something. Some people need to be restored to the Lord today. And it's going to cost you something.
Yeah.
You won't get by cheaply.
Yeah.
You must, hallelujah, it cost you to restore a marriage. It cost you to restore your finances.
Yeah.
How many of you have been working on your finances like me? I've been trying to get rid of my credit cards and they hang on. They hang on and they hang on, and I'm trying to get rid of them, trying to get rid of them, trying to get rid of them. They keep hanging on, brother and sister. It costs something. You've got to tighten your budget. You've got to tighten your belt. You've got to say no to some things.
Yeah.
It's going to cost you something. And let me tell you, if you want a deep move of God, it's going to cost you something in your life. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
There's some things you're going to have to sit back and say, oh, Lord, I can't do that. Hallelujah. It costs you something to restore. What about your relationship with God? It's going to cost you. Remember what happened to Samson? Cost him his life to have restoration with his father because he gave it up so easily. To restore our soul is very, very costly. Even though that Jesus paid the price, there are some things that we've got to pay for because we have willfully walked away from the Lord. Now, I want you to look at this. He leads me to the path of righteousness. That means we do things that's right. Amen? You can't cheat somebody and be right.
Amen.
I don't care. Oh, yeah, you can be. You belong to the church, have your name on the roll, members of the church. Amen. Claim to be saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. But yet you cannot be out here on the streets and Walmart and highways and byways and cheat people and not do right. God's people need to do things that are right. We can't be crooked as a barrel of fish hooks. Amen. And have a deep move of God. Hallelujah. He leads me to right paths. Has the Lord ever led you to the place you said, oh God, this can't be where you are leading me? Lord, this was not in my plan. No, it was not in your plan to have cancer, was it, brother? It wasn't my plan to have kidney failure.
Yeah.
Maybe it wasn't in your plan to have some of the things that's come upon you. It ain't got in your way. It was not in your plan. Hallelujah.
Hey.
Oh, praise God. When we get into those situations where we have no answer and we're seeking the Lord, it's then, praise God, that he'll glory to God. Then he'll bring us out by his power and by his strong hand.
Woo.
But he is leading us.
Yeah.
For his name's sake.
Not
for ours.
Yeah.
Not for ours.
Uh-huh.
I don't get the glory. Yeah. He gets the glory.
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And since I'm ministering again and pastoring again, I thank the Lord for his healing power.
Uh-huh.
And I never take any glory for it. I give it all unto God.
Woo.
Hallelujah. If I would take glory for it, I'd probably end up in the grave. But I'm telling you, every time I step behind the pulpit, I lift him up and give him glory. He's a mighty healer. He's an awesome God. Praise God. For his name's sake. Hallelujah. Trouble is, many churches want to build a name for themselves.
Amen.
They say, oh, come and see our wonderful pastor. Come and see our wonderful church. Come and see our wonderful this and our wonderful that. And try to build a name for themselves. When you leave this place, praise God, you can talk about your pastor. You can talk about your church, but all you must talk about Jesus. You must say, come and see a man and not a pastor. Come see Jesus. Hallelujah. He's in the midst of us as we gather together. Hallelujah. The faith. He is in the midst of us. And then he said he leads us through the valleys. The valleys are not too easy sometimes.
Amen.
Sometimes it's the valley of death. Death of what?
Yeah.
You need some things to die out of your life.
Oh,
I'm preaching better than your shouting. You need some things to die in your life. Hallelujah. He leads us through those valleys.
Yeah.
Do you know that the they don't have that kind of mountains here in this area. Down west, there's mountains so high that there's not even a tree can grow on top of the mountains.
Yeah.
Because there's no oxygen up there. You get above 10,000 feet, you run out of oxygen.
Yeah.
And there's nothing to get that. You can't even build a fire up there. And there's no trees on the top of those those rocky mountains. I'm telling you, it's in the valleys that our Lord hands us a bag of seed.
Yeah.
And said, in the valleys is where the fertile soil and the rich soil is. And there you're to take the seed, the word of God, and begin to, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Pray God, you need to take the word of the Lord. And when you come to see it, and you see people in need, you need to drop some seed in the ground. Hallelujah. And one day, hallelujah, you'll have a great harvest. Hallelujah. Because you planted seed in the valley of death.
Amen.
And seed will give you life. Amen. Yes, it will. Hallelujah. But some people like to be on Sunshine Mountain.
Yeah, amen.
Leaning back in their lazy boy rocker. But I'm telling you, the devil will come up on the backside of the town.
Amen.
And he'll flip you out of your lazy boy. And you'll go rolling down that hill. Amen. I've been there before. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm on the mountain now. Glory to God. First thing you know, I'm ending up in the valley again. God said it's time for you to plant some more seed. Time for you to minister my word. Time, hallelujah, to reach somebody.
Woo!
Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Woo!
It's in the valley that he crucifies me. He crucifies my desires. He crucifies my will.
Woo!
So that I can have his will. He crucifies the world. He crucifies my feelings. He crucifies my emotions. That way, when people offend me, it really doesn't offend me. When they talk about me, I can just go on and smile. Amen. Hallelujah.
Woo!
Glory to God. Listen to this, brother. God has brought you to this valley for a divine appointment. Because he's getting ready to do something wonderful in your life.
Yeah.
It's in the valley that you're transformed.
It's
in the valley that you're transfigured.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, you see him going into the valley. But now look, as he begins to come out of the valley. Hallelujah. Yea, though I walk through the aisle, will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff. They comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of my enemies. He's starting to transform you now.
Woo!
And bring you out.
Amen.
Oh, goody. He's going to take me to dinner. He's got a table set for me.
Yeah.
Where are we going, Lord? We're going to Ryan's? Where I can eat all I want to eat. We're going to Outback? Are we going to the Texas Roadhouse, Lord? Lord said, no, I'm preparing a table for you. In the presence of your enemies.
Yeah.
Glory to God. Why, Lord, in the presence of my enemies, so that you can minister unto them? And then the word of the Lord said, he anoints my head with oil. Glory to God.
Hey.
We're anointed right in the presence of our enemies. We're feasting right in the presence of our enemies. Hallelujah. You see, the enemies always want to pull you down. The enemies always want to take you down. The enemy always, and your enemies always want to defeat you. But praise God, God before you. Who can be against you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, no, you're not beneath, you're above. Glory to God. No, you're not the tail, you're the head. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're blessed of God.
Woo!
Hallelujah. I need some help in them. Brother Mark, come in and help me. Without God.
And he said, my cup runs over. See, God don't want you to just have your cup filled. He wants your cup to run over.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Somebody, all they want is just another feeling. Come to church for a feeling. He said, no, I want you to be so full that you run over and spill that on somebody else.
Amen.
And look at him. At first he talks about sheep. Now he's talking about a soldier. He's talking about a man who has strength and who has power. Who have been through the valley. But now, praise God, are standing there by the grace and the power of God. I believe I'm preaching to some people that's been in the valley. I believe some people that hear me this morning that has been in the valley. But praise God, you're coming out of the valley. Hallelujah. Then he said, and I have with me today two angels.
Amen.
This angel's name is goodness. This angel's name is mercy. He said, surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. Don't no matter where you go, goodness is here and mercy is here because the Lord is my shepherd. If I go through the valley, I look around, there he is. Goodness. Never left me, praise God. Glory to God. And sometimes God takes me to difficult places. Sometimes he gets me up on the mountain. It's so good to be on the mountain and rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. Even on the mountain, goodness and mercy is following me. Through my trouble, goodness and mercy still follow me. In the good times, goodness and mercy still follow me. In the bad times, goodness and mercy still follow me. When I'm sick and in the hospital, goodness and mercy is my side. Hallelujah. God has sent his angels watch over his sheep and over his people. Praise God. Goodness and mercy. All the days of my life. When I feel like it, goodness and mercy's there. When I don't feel like it, goodness and mercy's still there. Hallelujah. When I'm saved and I feel saved and saved, goodness and mercy is there. And when I don't feel like I'm saved, I don't feel like even a Christian, goodness and mercy is still there. Hallelujah. When I hear a trumpet sound, Pray right now that you makes you as you already are. The Spirit of God is already in this place. I pray, Lord, that the power of God would rest upon that soul today. One that's lukewarm and cold. Lord, the one that has walked away from you. Lord, the one that feels like that they're hopeless and they're helpless. Lord, the one that feels life is just so difficult. God, you are amazing to us this morning. Therefore, I come to you, Lord, now. I come to you with all my problems, with all my needs. All my doubts and fears. Hallelujah. And if you're beside someone that's lost, and you're a child of God, why don't you just speak to that person now and say, come to Jesus now. I'll go with you. Come on right now. I'm waiting on you. Don't move out from where you are. Right now in the name of the Lord. Come to this altar. Give your life to Him. In the name of the Lord, come quickly. Praise His name. Praise His name. Come quickly right now. Hallelujah. That's good. I'm going to tell my pastor, I just don't have the strength. I just don't want to come to the altar. But you just want to recognize that your need of prayer and your need of a Savior today. And you just want to lift up your hand right now in the name of the Lord. In this building, me. I'm not where I should be before. Come on. Praise the Lord. Yes, sister. Praise God. Hallelujah. I believe that there's others in this building today with great needs in your life. Sufficient God, He's Jehovah Jireh, our provider. Why don't you come right now? If you have a need, bring that come right now. If you have a need, would you come right now? So, may all glory to God. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound of saying, Amen. Thank you.
Lord.